Thank you, Tanya. It's wonderful to see you, and wonderful that you've agreed to become an ambassador for the charity.
Oh my God, I'm so happy, Henry. Thank you so much. I really, really am honoured to be part of ADHD UK. It's such a great charity, and it really, really is making a difference. And I'm just so honoured to be part of it. Thank you.
Well, we're honoured to have you as a part of it. And what you've been doing with the documentary is spectacular and incredibly important.
Hopefully we can make a difference together.
Absolutely looking forward to that. And thank you for agreeing to do this and agreeing to be part of the Global ADHD Conference.
Yeah.
And we're thrilled about that also. Straight into the questions.
Yes.
The first one's really just, it's for people to learn about you and your ADHD.
Okay.
Can you tell us your ADHD story from when you first had an inkling that you had ADHD and now?
So, do you know what, I never heard of girls having ADHD. So back in my generation, it was just sort of naughty children. But I was never really naughty. I was more like shy, a lot going on mentally. I was an introvert, very, very shy, but always a lot going on in my head. I got bullied, and growing up, there was always something, like, I just felt a bit detached from normal people, normal world, and for why they playing so effortlessly, and I find it really hard to, and it was like I was just viewing a TV of the world, and I was on my own, sort of thing. But didn't think anything of it, but I just thought that was a norm. And it was when I was 19, I was I went to the doctors, depression, anxiety, and they gave me antidepressants. And the GP just sort of threw these antidepressants at me. And this went on for, 20 years, 21 years. And it was when I got to nearly 40, and all these antidepressants, I was just trying in and coming off them and having like bad side effects. I paid private to go and see a specialist because I thought, I can't live this anxiety anymore. I was picking my fingers till they bleed, and my inner thoughts were just, it's like literally 20 TVs on in my head all shouting, and my leg was going, and I didn't realise any of that at the time. So when I went to see the specialist about anxiety, he watched me for an hour, and I kept thinking, he's watching me very closely. And he said, has anyone ever told you that you could have ADHD? And I was like, no. And I was shocked. So when I went home to tell my mum and Phil, and I was like, the doctor thinks I've got ADHD, because I thought my mum was going to say, you have not got that. I thought she was going to go mad, and she went, I've always known there was something. So I thought, why did you take me? because it just wasn't a thing. It's just, I've never heard of girls having it. And do you know what? When I found out that I did all the tests and everything, and I've got it of high spectrum, it was a relief. It was like thank God. I was happy.
Some people, like, they talk about being a relief, but also a sadness. Like,
yeah.
Did you have that? Was it?
Do you know, a lot of people say they have sadness and they're scared, but I just had complete relief. I had to, because I'd felt so alone, felt so just not right, so not normal, and I just felt complete happiness. And sort of when I met other people with ADHD, I felt like, I feel connected to someone. Like, I felt alone all my life. And now when I meet someone else with ADHD, I feel like, even if we don't get on, even if I've just met them, I just feel like, it's my people.
when you try to explain ADHD, how do you explain it?
It's so hard to explain ADHD, but it is like I've got 17 TVs on in my head, and they never switch off. And I call them like the genius ideas. I can have about 7 genius ideas of business ideas in a day, and I'll get so excited, and I'll think, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. And then when I do all of that, and I promise this, I promise that, and then all of a sudden, I've overwhelmed myself. Like, and that's why I've got so many businesses. I'm hyper-focused. I'm on it. Everything's colourful, and I'm just, like, zooming away. And then all of a sudden, boom, overwhelmed, and I'm just completely inner paralysed. And it's sort of, I'm in between those two worlds. And that's how, it's so hard to, it's like an inner restlessness.
It is hard to talk
it's
about.
So hard.
That's why it's a core question.
Yeah.
Once again, many people giving an explanation.
Because it's like, so you're either hyper or you're just completely can't move. And it's, but I'm not hyper whereas when I'm running around. It's my head and no one can see it.
Yeah.
So loads of people say, well, ADHD. Like my husband goes, where's your hyperness? It's in my head. And do you know what? One of the worst traits that I've always had, and I realise it now, is say when I was bullied and I was hyper-focusing on people, what people thought of me. So then I was sort of talking myself into a black hole. And now, so I have to really, really brainwash myself with positivity. Otherwise, I can hyper-focus on, oh, they think this about me, they think that about me, this, oh, I'm not good enough. I can, if I hyper-focus on one by four and I can just, and I can't get off that train. So now I catch myself and I get myself off that train, writing down, meditation, and just sort of brainwashing. I have to brainwash myself because that hyper-focus, if that goes down that negative train, it's hard to, it can take you to a really dark place if you don't know that you're hyper focusing on this dark stuff. And I've took myself down to almost suicide by doing that. So that's my number one thing is, and that's why I think being diagnosed is so important, to realize hyper focus. You don't just hyper focus on, you know, on social media. They go, oh, you're hyper focusing on hobbies. You can hyper focus on negative stuff that can take you down. So that's a recognize that and get yourself off that.
Well, thank you for sharing.
Yeah.
That and sharing that where your feelings went on that.
Yeah.
It is important. Would you be happy to share your medication story?
Yeah, so I was really excited to start my medication because I thought, oh my God, I've got ADHD and the psychiatrist is going to give me these pills and I'm going to be fixed. I tried the first one and God, I was happy. I had no mental chatter. I was relaxed, but I was sort of like, I sat like that. I was so calm, so happy. But I was filming for a TV show and it needed personality and it needed me to speak and move. But I just sat like that, zoned out. So I thought, I can't earn money or it just took away anything. Internally, I was happy. And probably when I get to about 95, I'm going to refine those tablets and just sit like happy. But I'm not 95. And you know what? I still need to be me, not just this zombie. Even though internally I was happy. So I tried the next one and then that was giving me a dry mouth and I was doing like really, really biting my nails and one of them actually, my veneer came off. I was like, and that's not a good look. So that they had to go. And then the third ones, I kept having heart palpitations and I didn't realise it at the time, but looking back, I was forgetting to eat. And then I kept going, oh, this out. But then I was hyper-focused. So I thought, this is great. I'm getting loads of work done. Because I thought the other two were not so good. I was getting so much work done. I kept going, oh, my God, my heart. We're just working through it and not eating. And ended up having a seizure, which really scared my friends and family and me, of course. So after recovering with that, I had to come off the medication. I think it was just too much and being given antidepressants since for 20 years when I haven't got anxiety and depression, it was ADHD. I think the chemicals in my brain, it was just too much and yeah, I had a seizure. So now I I do the natural route, which I'm not about natural, Henry, at all. I'm about implants, veneers. There's nothing natural about me apart from my ADHD medication, which shocks everyone. So I'm like, meditate. I wake up in the morning and I'm religious, so I have to sit my earphones in, meditate, and I pray, which is just quieting my mind down. The cold showers, I hate them. It's so good. Exercise, hate exercise, but have to exercise every day. Have to have a routine and I have to sleep. I'm like a baby, so I have to have my sleep. And it's eating and it's doing all the things that everyone knows they should do, but they don't do, but you have to do them. Otherwise, if you don't have routine, my life is just going to go into toxic mess, chaos. So I've got a choice. I have my routine. It's the little things that add up to a nice life. It's routine or chaos. That's the choice I've got.
Thank you. I love that phrase, it's routine or chaos.
Yeah.
Which will particularly resonate, presumably with you, for any parent of an ADHD kid.
Oh, yeah,
like,
yeah.
It applies to adults just as much.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
You touched on it a bit, how your ADHD has impacted your work.
Yeah.
I suppose the wider question on how do you think being ADHD and being in the media, being on TV, do you think that's a good idea or a bad idea? Or what's your view?
I've got two mindsets about people with ADHD being on TV, and it depends on their core personality, really. It's such a hard one because you can have a nice person with ADHD and you can have I don't really know where I stand with it, but I do think that ADHD, it's hard because off camera.
What would your advice be to someone with ADHD looking to pursue a career in TV? We obviously as a charity, right?
Yeah.
We support people.
Completely.
We want to see those people representing.
Definitely. But also, I think channels have to look after, because sometimes you can impulsively say or act things, because as scientists, so we have a think it. But I suppose that's when you're younger. Like now, I wouldn't. It's really hard to. God, I'm being so ADHD right now. I've got so many conversations going on in my head, but I think ADHD, you should be able to do whatever the hell you want, no matter what. But I also, my mother's instinct is look after them, the channels look after them. If they say something they don't mean because it's just an impulse, then don't show that and hang them out to dry. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, thank you. What would young, undiagnosed Tanya think of you now?
I think she'd be proud. And I think she'd probably think she's not grown up. I'm still the same me. And I think that's one of my good characters, is I'm still young at heart.
If you could speak to that young Tanya, what would you say to them?
I'd probably put my hand over their mouth and just say, "Say ADHD, don't say it. Think. Do the CBT. Think before you speak." I'd like to cuddle her, and I'd like to just stroke her head and all those thoughts and all those horrible thoughts. So just give her a cuddle and just say, "It's okay. It's okay."
Can you tell us why you did it? What your views of ADHD have changed through doing it?
I was on a reality show for 7 years, and someone's birthday. It's not my birthday, everyone.
Probably have a little pause. There's a second part to that also, which is what was the most surprising revelation? Was there anything, was there a particular... scroll back to the, like, you've done a documentary.
So I was on a TV show for 7 years, and I was loads of side effects with the antidepressants and everything, and that's when things got really, my anxiety got really bad whilst filming. And I was just struggling with everyday life. And it was when I was on the show that I discovered that I had ADHD. And I was struggling with that medication. And I just thought, I need to be able to control myself. I need to be in control of my life and my ADHD before I can film anymore. So I left... which gave me more time, and then I got offered a documentary, and I jumped at the chance because I thought it's going to lead me to amazing people, which it has with you, Henry, and I've been on a journey, and I knew I had ADHD, but I had a lot to learn. I mean, I'm nearly 40, I've just been told I've got ADHD, and this gave me the chance to go on a journey and learn more about it and learn more about the different aspects of it and meet lots of different people with it. And I'm babbling on in an ADHD way. But yeah, it's one of the best decisions I've ever made.
It's a big deal you telling the world you've got ADHD. Like, it's a, generally, yeah. It is a big deal.
Yeah.
And it means a lot to a lot of people.
Yeah.
As you've come out talking about your ADHD, what are the sort of positives and negatives you found about from that?
I was so scared about coming out that I had ADHD because I thought, are people going to think I'm just a nutter? And are people going to see me different? And I thought, everyone's always said I'm a nutter anyway, so what? And do you know what? I've had nothing but positivity. And the thousands, hundreds of thousands of messages straight away. I think I've got it. I've always known what you said has resonated. My son, my daughter, everyone somehow has got a story about ADHD relating to them and wanting to know more information. And that's why I was so keen on doing the documentary, because so many people have so many questions that are unanswered, including myself.
Oh, thank you. Do you have a favourite ADHD strategy?
My favourite ADHD strategy is praying to God. And it's not really God, it's a higher power. So I'm not really religious, but I get on my hands and knees. And sort of my hands near my heart. It's more of a meditation, but in a prayer pose. And it's more breathing, really. And it's just focusing on what I want instead of, because you could, that hyper-focus can take you down. And if I get on my hands and knees, it's more of changing my state, changing my pose, that will take me out of that, sort of changing the hyper-focus of negativity. So it's knees, hands, and just that. And a cold shower. There's nothing like shaking your brain out of a negative hyperfocus on a cold shower, but it really does work.
Well, not like that.
And it burns fat.
I do know. Last question. So this is a... it's a traditional last question. What impact of your ADHD has made you saddest? And what has made you happiest? And if you could do saddest first and happiest last, so we end on a high.
What impact has my ADHD, my personal ADHD?
Your ADHD had that made you saddest.
Okay, so the one that's made me saddest is seeing my mum and dad's face when they knew that I tried to take my own life. Because nothing can... I just can't even imagine what it would be like if I knew that one of my babies has tried to take their own life. I'd just be... and they've given me nothing but an amazing, amazing life. and it's just an internal struggle that I knew nothing about and they knew nothing about. I mean, they always knew that I had something not... but yeah, that's the saddest thing, just seeing the sadness in their eyes. And but the happiest thing is doing this documentary and saying, finding out basically. I think God put me in, I say God, my higher power, was whoever I pray to, put me on the show, and I discovered I had ADHD so that I could tell other people and my story could, I feel like we're all learning as we go along, the people who've been messaging me anyway, there's thousands and thousands of ladies and men. I'm babbling on because I've been sidetracked by the first bit.
Well, thank you for sharing the first bit. It's quite...
Yeah, but it does get better. It does get better. And I think the more work we do, the more community we can grow, the more people will know about it. And I'm babbling on again.
How does it make you feel to know that you've got this ADHD learning and understanding and being able to help your son?
Do you know what? As soon as I recognised the signs with my son, like, well, he's always had it, but it took till I got diagnosed for me to, and it's only when everyone was going, me and Rocco have always been the same, like our anger outbursts or like, ah! Everything about us has always been the same. So he wouldn't have been diagnosed if I hadn't have been. So he could have easily gone through the same pain that I did. So I feel really, really lucky that hopefully, touch wood, that he'll never tell me that he's had to try to take his own life like my mum and dad had to find out. Hopefully.
Thank you so much for sharing all of that. Thank you for all you've been doing.
No, thank you, Henry. You're making such a big difference and I really appreciate it. You're just making such a big community and I think it's brilliant.
None
of us are on our own. We've all got each other.
We are again together. It is a wonderful thing.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Thank you for all you're doing. Thank you for the documentary you're doing. Thank you for the work you're doing. Thank you for being an ambassador.
Oh, thank you, Henry. Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks.